everyone, welcome back to GK Today. I'm Nuzhat Sana and in this video I'll discuss today's top current and static general studies questions for UPSC prelims examination 2022 onwards. And these questions are framed keeping in view both the factual as well as analytical aspects of UPSC prelims exam. Also, I would like to inform you that these questions are part of GK Today's UPSC prelims test series, which is available in GK Today Android app. And the test series for 2022 prelims examination comprises total of 7500 questions, divided 2500 questions on current general studies and 5000 questions on static general studies. And the series has started from May 2021 and it will end with UPSC prelims examinations 2022. So if you wish to access all questions of GK Today UPSC prelims test series, you may subscribe the test series in the app. So now without wasting any further time, let's get started.
So today this is our 18th lecture and now let's start. Question number 1. To foster an innovative ecosystem focusing on SDG related sectors, India has entered into the Global Innovation Partnership with DASH. First of all, let's understand what is Global Innovation Partnership. Actually, it is a partnership between India and UK to foster an innovative ecosystem that focuses on sustainable development goals. How? So basically, it will support the innovators to scale up their innovations in other countries to help their exploration of new markets and their sustainability. And the partnership will aid the innovators through seed funding, grants, some type of technical assistances or investments. Okay. So basically we can say that this partnership will support the Indian innovators to scale up their innovations in any third country, thereby helping them to explore new markets and become self-sustainable. So through these processes, the partnership will support the Indian entrepreneurs and the innovators to test, scale up and take their innovative development solutions to selected any other third developing countries. Okay. So this is a partnership between India and UK. Question number 2, with reference to Sutra, and Sutra stands for susceptible, undetected, tested and removed approach, the government-backed model for understanding the progress of the COVID-19 pandemic, consider the following statements. So regarding Sutra, two statements have been given. Let's check it. First statement says, its beta parameter measures the contact rate. And the second statement says, its epsilon parameter determines the time taken in pandemic to reach peak. Actually, talking about Sutra, it is government-backed model for understanding the progress of COVID-19 pandemic and it has basically three parameters, okay? First is beta, or you can say contact rate. Basically, it measures the number of people who are infected by an infected person in any particular day. So this is called as beta, okay? Then second parameter is called reach. And it determines the exposure of the people to the pandemic. And the third, which is the main parameter, is called epsilon, and it is the ratio of detected COVID cases to undetected COVID cases. Okay. So now let's go to the options again. First statement is beta parameter measures the contact rate. This is absolutely correct. But second statement says epsilon parameter determines the time taken in pandemic to reach peak. No. Epsilon parameter says what is the ratio between detected COVID cases to undetected COVID cases. Fine. So this is wrong and correct answer becomes only one. Now let's talk about some of the problems of Sutra. Actually, the main problem is the prediction of this model are too variable to guide any government policy because this factor rely on too many parameters. That's why it is unable to give any accurate result. Okay. And as far as the model is concerned, it is observing change in parameter values and it does not care about what is the reason behind the change. Okay. So it just checks the value and it has nothing to do with the reason. Okay. So these are some of the drawbacks of this particular model. Fine. Now next question. With reference to various government entities disinvested in past, consider the following matters. So you have to basically identify the government entity which is given here and its acquirer is the correct match or not, okay? First is Bharat Aluminium Company Limited, Adani Group. Balco, or you can say Bharat Aluminium Company Limited, is an aluminium company that was sold to Vedanta Resources in the year 2000. And it is noted for its development of special aluminium alloys for Agni and Prithvi missiles. So this has not been sold to Adani Group, rather Vedanta Resources should be written here, okay? So this is wrong. Second is Indian Petrochemicals Corporation Limited, Reliance Industries. This is actually a petrochemical company that was sold to the Reliance Industries Limited in the year 2003. This is absolutely correct. And third is Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, Tata Group. So yes, this was acquired by Tata Group in the year 2008 and later renamed as Tata Communications. Also, VSNL is credited with bringing internet to India. So yes, this is also correct and right answer becomes only 2 and 3. Also, one more thing I have to tell you. HPCL, that is Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited, is a Maharatna public sector unit. And in the year 2018, ONGC acquired a major stake of HPCL. Fine. Now, next question. Which of the following chemicals are herbicides or weedicides? First of all, let's understand the difference between herbicides and weedicides. See, herbicides are used to control growth of small plants, while weedicides are used to control the growth of weeds, you can say, in specific, okay? Then second difference is, herbicide is a substance that is used to kill plants, while weedicide is simply weed killer. So they are mainly designed for plants, but weedicides are just sprayed on weeds during their vegetative growth before they blossom and produce seeds, okay? And weedicide has no negative impact on crops, and the herbicide are often used in induced areas and in farms. Fine. Now let's come to the options. First is glyphosate. What is this? It is actually a broad spectrum herbicide that was recently banned by the state of Telangana. That's why it was in news. Why it was banned? Because it is an organophosphorus compound that has potential to cause cancers. Okay? So yes, this is right. Second is Linuron. This is used as a weedicide and it is used for removing weeds including grass from crops such as soybeans, and this was also banned in the year 2018. Yes, this is also true. Then third is Trifluralin. This is pre-emergence weedicide that kills weed by inhibiting root formation and it is toxic to aquatic life forms. So yes, this is also true. And last is sodium cyanide, which is another banned herbicide in India. And it is not only used in agriculture, it is also used unsustainably in gold mining and illegally in cyanide fishing. Actually, all are the herbicides or weedicides. So correct answer becomes option number D. Now last question, which of the following agreements or arrangements pertain to India's bilateral relations with European Union? First is BECA, that is Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement. So this is an agreement under negotiation between India and European Union since the year 2007. And this FTA negotiation was stalled in the year 2013. Let me make it more clear. Actually, it will provide Indian military systems with high quality GPS to navigate and missiles with real time intelligence to precisely target the adversary. Also, it will give access to topographical and aeronautical data and products that will aid navigation and targeting. Okay, so yes, this is right. And second is Comprehensive Connectivity Partnership, that is CCP. So recently, India and European Union has launched this CCP to improve cooperation in the areas of transport, digital connectivity, energy, and also people-to-people ties. Now, why it was in news? Because recently, India and European Union have announced a CCP to support resilient and sustainable connectivity projects in India and in other nations, for example, Africa, Central Asia, Indo-Pacific. Basically, at those places where India is looking forward to boost regional trade and influence. Okay? And the third is Clean Energy and Climate Partnership. So this was launched in the year 2016 during the India-European Union Summit. So yes, this is also correct. And right answer becomes all 1, 2 and 3. Now let's see one thing. Why European Union is so important to India? Because first of all, it is India's third largest trading partner after China and USA. Then secondly, it is the second largest destination for India's exports. Also, India is European Union's 10th largest trading partner. And the trade in goods between European Union and India have increased by 72% in the last decade. So these all are the reasons why India and European Union are making these agreements, fine? So that's it for today. I hope you have liked the session. If you want to give any review, feedback or suggestion regarding these lectures, you can tell us in the comment section. Definitely we will try to implement that. And now we'll meet again tomorrow with 5 more new and interesting questions. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you so much for watching. And please do not forget to subscribe to GK Today. With this, Meenu Zahid Sana signing off.